There is only one very important reason why investors have been ignoring telltale signs of overall weakness. Sure, we have the stock buybacks and low interest rates, but the truth is that we have central banks who have made promises and growing numbers of people who actually believe them. In previous cycles, it was typical for central banks to reduce interest rates when a recession hit. Today, that will not happen because interest rates will already be at rock bottom. Attempting to prevent a future crisis is an incredibly dangerous path to go down. Hang on tight. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Of course, globally, we could see negative interest rates occur just like they have in so many other countries. The United States hasn't experienced it yet. But in real terms, if you look at it when factoring in inflation, when you have seen what has actually happened to the average individual, this isn't a good sign for what's coming because the central banks might have to actually go further and further down. They're going to hit zero, realize it's not enough, and bring interest rates down into the negative. And this, if you look at Europe, if you look at Japan, other places, interest rates into the negative has no positive effects, okay? Time and time again, the central banks make bigger and bigger mistakes. And of course, as the debt increases, that becomes more and more of a problem. Today, I have an absolutely jam-packed episode. I want to cover a lot of information and I will get into what I believe is the most important chart, something I have shown before. But first, I want to cover a few issues so that my friends who stick by the videos will be able to see that in a few minutes. But let's cover this first. Technology stocks head towards their best year since 2009. I covered this on the community or blog section of my channel today, just mentioning the fact that there is not even once in this entire article did they talk about stock buybacks. The primary reason why these particular companies have seen their stocks rise, the biggest buyer of these technology stocks has been the companies themselves. And does anybody see a coincidence here? The mainstream media might have forgot to mention that one. Well, of course, we know how this all works. They talk about the earnings. They talk about how they have new technologies coming out all the time. They're referring to this technology and they're referring to this particular future investment that they have and this and that, but not stock buybacks. Okay, well, this is the way it always works. I mean, they are not going to actually admit what's causing problems. They're not going to let you know beforehand. Anytime there's any ever crisis or even the concerns, they always push them off. And we see that time and time again. Look at this. Markets are overbought, but there's not much worry on Wall Street yet. The market may be overbought, but overbought markets can last for an extended period. That is absolutely true. I agree with that. Technology stocks are leading the march to new highs. It covers some further details in this article, but it really connects me in with this. Risk appetite momentum is at historical highs. This is out of Goldman Sachs. The GS risk appetite momentum indicator, and it is right now near record high. And that should not surprise anybody. We have seen so many different indicators just like this, approaching highs, breaking the highs, new records all the time in so many different ways. Right now, I'm seeing a euphoria that has actually exceeded the dot-com bubble, and not specifically with those technology stocks, but just in general. The risk on mentality is crazy when I see it because time and time again, people do get burned. And right now we are seeing more leverage being used than before. Although statistically, it may not necessarily show up when you look at totals, but if you see what the average person is doing with ETFs and so on, this is going to be a big problem in the near future. Okay, so this particular economic forecaster is from the ECRI. I've shown you some charts from there before. I'm going to touch on some points in this article out of CNBC. As stocks continue to hit new highs, he's worried investors are wrongly assuming an economic revival is underway. The actual data itself is just decelerating pretty hard, actually. I don't think we can remove recession risk from the table. It's still out there as long as you're slowing. So he mentions a few of the issues, and we'll talk about that right now. He sees the downward trend particularly affecting two key points of the economy, retail sales and industrial production. On the manufacturing side, you have IP, industrial production, at a 3.5-year low. It's deeply negative. On the retail sales front, you're having deceleration. I wanted to mention something about retail sales. I think it's really important that we get the data going through Q4. I want to know if people are just waiting off on purchases in order to get those discounts that they know are coming in Q4 when they have their Boxing Week and Black Friday and so on. Will that make a change? Now, we usually do see a spike in the actual total sales from Q3 into Q4, but we're going to actually get that data. I will bring charts for you, of course. All the hopes are the consumer is somehow going to rev up. That's coinciding with the holiday season here. But when we look at all of our leading indexes that anticipate turning points in the US economy, it's not there yet. So we have more slowdown to go. A couple of months before the Great Recession, markets hit an all-time high. In 1990, right when that recession was starting, markets hit an all-time high. In 2001, they actually hit a high after the recession started. People need to know that information. Always, 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 we go in with this trend. So here's the trend line. Let's say it's going up and up and up. But along the way, we get these ups and downs. And this is just the way it works, okay? So the market always reacts to the top and to the bottom. And during these times, people get overreacting in what they do. And I do think that with all of the ETFs, because you have this concentration into these fewer and fewer bits, coupled with all the computer algorithms and so on, we know the story there. Look at the percentage of central banks that are easing right now. I mean, this is crazy. And to note, this is going to change big time in the coming months because some of these central banks have simply held off. They haven't necessarily increased their interest rates, but they're kind of just holding, waiting and seeing. There are very few examples of central banks around the world that have actually increased their interest rates recently. In order to push interest rates down, as you know, open market operations need to happen. They need to print money, that's the way it works, that can't last forever without inflationary pressures taking hold. Another day, another Fed repo. You can see the Fed adds $102 billion to the financial system in the latest repo transactions. The details here at the bottom, it breaks it down for you. Just wanted to give you an update on this to show you what the Federal Reserve is up to. They consistently, day after day after day, need to intervene in the markets in QE4, and that is a very clear sign of weakness. How can anybody deny that? It's absolutely ridiculous. And that connects me in with this. If you do a search for Fed bailed out Canada, you can see it for yourself among the 10 million results that come up. The very first thing is you see the video of none other than the Money GPS. I broke it down, and in this, I actually show you the information that the vast majority of people in the financial industry do not know about. The fact that the former prime minister said Canadian banks did not get a bailout. And meanwhile, we found out that they actually did, but it wasn't from the Bank of Canada. It was from the Federal Reserve. People need to understand the way that this system works. It's a lot of it is under the table, okay? You're not gonna get it at face value. I created this video, even though it's at the very top of the list. Can you believe it? Very few people have actually watched it. But that's the way it works anyway. Take a look at this chart here. The most important chart. If you stuck around this far into the video, you get what I believe is the most important chart. Anytime we reference what the central banks are doing, in my opinion, that is at the very top of the list. Global central bank net securities purchases in the trillions of dollars, and you could see what has happened over the years. And I want to make something very clear. 2018 was terrible. 93% of assets were in the red for the year, and then that turned around. Right in those last few days of 2018, we saw the markets roaring higher, and they basically haven't stopped all throughout. I mean, we have had some problems along the way, and the market up until recently was unable to surpass its previous highs, but something changed. Of course, we have had more easy money policies. In 2018, you could see this downward swing, and maybe if I didn't use red, we'd be able to actually see it better, but take a look at this. If you notice, the central banks globally were printing less and less and less. And that right there shows you that contraction became a huge problem for global equities and for financial markets in general. Even though you might not think that these central banks are printing up money and buying stocks, that isn't a factor here. This is actually supporting those markets, any of the financial markets, in fact, by devaluing the currencies. Things really change. There's a whole lot to this, of course, things that I've covered many, many times before. But of course, the thing changed big time in 2019 because we saw the Federal Reserve, we saw the Bank of England, we saw the Bank of Japan, the PBOC, and every other central bank around the world saying, we are going to print money, and the ECB, of course, too. We are going to print money. We're going to make sure that this thing keeps moving, keeps chugging along. And this, in my opinion, is the number one factor. This is it. Not necessarily just interest rates, but what the Federal Reserve and their friends do with their balance sheets. Really quick, I wanted to mention this, the central bank liquidity swap operations. This is something that, although at face value, it might not be so telling, but as we run into the next crisis, this might be much more important. You could see these swap facilities designed to improve liquidity conditions in global money markets and to minimize the risk that strains abroad could spread to the US markets by providing foreign central banks with the capacity to deliver US dollar funding to institutions in their jurisdictions. This was really big during the financial crisis, and I just wanted to show it to you here because this data is available directly on the New York Fed site. It is updated very frequently. I wanted to make you aware of it if you aren't already. Link will be in the description. Last 3 weeks have seen equity flows eclipse bond flows for the first time since early December. Big, big change here. These blue lines are equity flows minus bond flows. And take a look at that. Finally, things have changed. And why? Because risk on, baby. QE4 is here to stay. Let's pour our money into the stock market. Within equities, flows have been rotating away from the US and going into the rest of the world. That's interesting as well because the US is seen as a safe haven. Let's not invest in emerging markets. Let's not invest in Europe. Let's put our money in what we believe is safe, or at least safer, and that's the US. Well, the money seems to be going elsewhere as well. The blue line, US minus the rest of the world equity. And while, of course, we have seen the stock market in the United States going higher, this just shows you comparing the US to the rest of the world. Equities are pricing in strong rebounds in the PMIs. I'm not sure if that's really going to happen. Only time will tell. I don't necessarily like these type of predictive estimations and so on, but it just shows you what could happen. Right now, we have seen the PMIs, manufacturing, everything that's connected in with that slumping big time from 2018 into 2019. We'll see if it turns around just like the stock market. I was going to do a whole report just on this and connect it in with a few other points, but I'll just mention it really quickly because this is how this affects people. What I've shown you just over these last 10, 15 minutes, whatever it is, really hits people at home in a different manner that most can't really see. Many Americans over 65 face economic insecurity, even if they're healthy. This breaks it down. It's called the Elder Index. Gives you a breakdown here. And in my opinion, what we have seen throughout this period of time is that central banking doesn't make things better, it makes things more expensive, and it hurts those in the bottom 90% the most. There's also another chart in here, you know, if you just want to see the breakdown according to the state and so on. I'll leave this article in the links, of course, as always. I just wanted to show you this one before we finish the video. A similar situation with Canadians. For working and retired Canadians alike, the golden years never looked so glum. Among Canadians still in the workforce, 3/4 do not have a financial plan. 47% believe there's a serious risk they could outlive their retirement savings. And 44% expect to still be working full-time at the age of 66. Now, this is a sample size, as always, but it goes in line with all of the others that I have shown you, okay? The same problems are going on all over the world. People think, they actually think that their pension fund, that their retirement funds are going to be what they are told. And sadly, they have been swindled. They have been taken for granted. They have been taken advantage of. And that's truly unfortunate. If you found this video informative, smash the like button. When you hit the button harder, it counts as 2 likes, so I really do appreciate that. If you want to build a business online, if you were ever interested in how e-commerce works, maybe you don't want to do anything in terms of actually investing, but you just want to learn, check out the Amazon GPS. I created it. It's a free e-course, and it's available at theamazongps.com. For those who want to know about the financial system, about interest rates, about central banks, about how to make money, all of that information is contained within these 2 books. These are the 2 books that I wish existed prior to me writing them. It would have saved me a lot of time, I assure you. If you want them, the links are in the description. If you want the audiobook, that's at themoneygps.com. This right here is an extremely important video, and if you haven't watched it, just click it. I'll see you over there.